Good evening. I'd like to call to order the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting of April 16th, 1991. The first order of business this evening is to approve the minutes of the previous meeting. Has the board had a chance to review? If so, any comments on the minutes? Judy?
I have one correction on the March 19th minutes. On page 10, it indicates that Mr. Parkhurst was appointed a voting member, and I believe it should be Mr. Eichenberg.
Page 10?
It's about midway down the page, a one-sentence paragraph.
Okay. Mr. Parkhurst, is that the way you remember it?
I indicated that there's a sentence saying Mr. Parkhurst was appointed a voting member on this item, and since that wouldn't make sense, it must have been Mr. Eichenberg.
I believe I was reappointed because I had stepped down from the previous issue.
Oh, okay.
The previous issue would have been the Highlands, and that's true.
Okay. I didn't know he needed to be appointed.
I think it's because the previous article had lasted so long, and I'd sort of forgotten that we needed Mr. Parkhurst back on the board.
Okay, thank you.
That's why it was so late in the minutes. Any other comments? Do I hear a motion?
To adopt them as distributed?
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of accepting the minutes as written, raise your right hand. Opposed? It's a unanimous vote. The workshop minutes of April 2nd need a consensus to be accepted. Any changes, corrections? Seeing none, we'll accept the minutes of the workshop April 2nd. Numerous items of correspondence, and I'll try to cruise down through them as quickly as I can. There's a letter from Maureen O'Meara, our town planner, on the Dead End Streets Ordinance Amendment that was recommended to the town council. A letter from our town attorney, I believe this is from Tom Leahy, no, from Michael Hill, in reference to Dead End Streets. 1989 assessment of visual resources of Cape Elizabeth, and I've had a chance only to read about half of this myself. I urge all of the planning board members to take a look at this. Our workshop last on the 2nd of April dealt with our comprehensive plan, and I think this blends in very well with a lot of our discussion. An article copied for us, Protection Against Liability for Landowners Who Allow Public Access, was distributed as part of our packet to Variners. We talked about this a little bit at the workshop meeting from the Marine Law Institute. I think it was donated by Tim Eichenberg, our board member. Also distributed, but I didn't happen to get one. Contacts with applicants package, I already have one, so I guess that's why. And again, I urge all the board members to study that thoroughly. 1988 Greenbelt Plan. I had never seen this myself, and I, again, along with the comprehensive plan, we're getting quite a few volumes of extremely pertinent information. The affordable housing meeting, notified Wednesday, April 24th, 1991, panel discussion on affordable housing that's working. And I believe this is a League of Women Voters presentation. I received in the mail give to our planner which you may have a copy. A letter from our town attorney in reference to the Richard Davis appeal. A letter dated today from our town attorney In reference to proposed letter of credit for the Greater Portland Development Group to be issued by the People's Heritage Bank with regard to the Highlands at Broad Cove, where our town attorney addresses some issues with that letter of credit. Do you need it? Do you have a copy of this? Okay. Also received by delivery a letter outlining several points in reference to the Broad Cove Highlands, as it's referred to, development from Edward and Rachel Perry of 10 Pine Ridge Road. So received, not sure the sponsor, a brochure, Hello BMPs for Construction. Just received this after. What is it? Oh, Best Management Practices, Erosion and Sediment Control Handbook for Construction. And lastly, a letter from, I believe it's Michael Brown, which is on our podium tonight, referencing several concerns in reference to the Highlands of Broad Cove. I believe that entails the correspondence. First order of old business this evening is the Public Works garage addition. The addition located at Jordan Way and proposed by the Town of Cape Elizabeth. Public hearing, site plan review, section 19-2-9. Before we start the public hearing, I guess I'd just very briefly like to have...
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I have to step down on this matter because we are under contract with the Town of Cape Elizabeth. So I'll excuse myself.
Certainly. The alternates, do you remember which one I appointed it on? Okay, I'll reappoint Mr. Eichenberg as a voting member for this article. If the representative of the applicant could just come to the podium, address the board, give your name and address. Introduce just a brief outline, and then sure. We'll get to the public hearing.
Good evening. My name is Bob Malley. I'm the Public Works Director. And before we get going, I'd just like to make a few introductions of people that are here tonight that have been associated with the project from its inception. From the firm of Design Alliance, Baron Stallman and Bruce Butler are here tonight. William Bray is here, who performed the traffic study for the project. Sean Frank is here from the firm of Sebago Technics, who worked on the site plan. Frederick Morin is here from the firm of T.Y. Lynn Hunter Ballou Associates, who performed the review of the project for the town. And representing the school department is Connie Goldman, who was the superintendent of schools and has been familiar with the project.
Thank you very much. At this time, I'd like to call to order the public hearing. The public hearing on this article is simply that, a chance for the public to make comment, ask questions, raise concerns about the proposed Public Works garage addition. I'd ask each member to come to the podium and introduce yourself by name and your residence. Make a brief comment. Just so I have some sense of timing here, how many people here intend to make some comment, public comment, on this public garage? One, two, okay.
Mr. Chairman, before we get public comment, perhaps we could have just a very short introduction from the applicant about what he intends to do.
Okay, I'm certainly willing to, especially since we left our last meeting with a number of questions. There have been changes that were apparent in our packet, perhaps to bring the rest of the general public up to speed on what those changes since the last 30 days. We could take 5 minutes into that.
I think it would be a good time to have Barry Stallman go over the revisions to the plan, because there have been some important revisions that may be helpful for the public hearing. Okay.
Do you want drawings that would face more the public, or... You have copies of them.
Right. Why don't you just turn them so that the public can see.
since the last meeting, we have revised the circulation on Connection Road, which connects the elementary school complex to the high school complex. That road has it is currently a two-way road, and the road is going to be made one-way in the direction leading from the elementary school complex to the high school complex. Jordan Way is still to be closed off as was originally proposed, with a gate placed in this location here, and a barrier of plantings and sidewalks so that one could safely walk between the two school complexes. There is one curb cut located in the general location of the public works facility, and that is for both vehicles to come in and load up on gas, and for maintenance vehicles to be able to get to the ball field for repairs. There has been at the high school.
Can you just turn about the 90 degree?
How's that?
Much better.
Is that okay?
You felt left out, did you?
There's an 8.5 by 11 sketch showing a left turn lane in the area of the egress-ingress road to the high school. We had to do some scaling off of some off-the-aerial photos, and it's turned out our scale was wrong, and Bill Bray just advised us tonight that the road, which we show is 20 feet wide, is in reality 16 feet wide. And he's further advised us that he felt that 22 feet overall would be sufficient, which would necessitate, rather than a 12-foot wide cut being made in that center island, that a 6-foot wide cut would be acceptable.
So the event of width will be the road recommended for 22 to 24?
That's correct. Okay, we have added as I mentioned earlier, we've added the sidewalk, which is now shown going up the entire right-hand side of the road if you're going up the wrong way. We have shown an additional walkway to the IGA located in this area of the site, and there still is some negotiations and discussions we've not heard back from the generating company as to whether they want to build it on their property or not. So that it's in your package, I believe, stated that way, and we would propose not to build it, obviously, onto their property should they say no. We have revised the lower parking lot in this area. We had one stall that we had eliminated for a back around. There are now two stalls that were revised. And we will be restriping the high school parking lot located to the south of the new employee parking lot for Department of Public Works vehicles. Another revision is the temporary maintenance equipment storage area, which is located in here, will not be striped, but we're proposing that it be signed. And there will be a sign rather than go through the cost of, I think one, the cost of striping the entire area, and I think quite frankly it would be unsightly to take the whole area and start striping. We've added a number of signs, and if you look carefully, I can review them with you, or I can answer questions on about the signage at a later date.
Not at a later date, but a later time.
At a later time. Yes, hopefully not a later date. Also in your package, you have a detail of this gate, which is located here, and that's off the National Parks standard gate that they use in the parks. And we felt that the style of the gate was much more in keeping with Cape Elizabeth than going into some metal monster that would also be a maintenance problem because it would have to be painted and constantly upgraded. And we feel this would be a maintenance-free and an attractive-looking gate, and quite in keeping with the plantings along the Esplanade.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like for Mr. Stallman to address the signage now, if he would.
Okay.
At the intersection of Jordan Way and Route 77, Ocean House Road, there will be a sign that says not a through street. Please tell me if I'm missing it. There will be a stop sign located on the other side of the controlled access point, which really is intended for vehicles that are coming through here to slow down and watch it if they're in an emergency situation. There is another sign located right here, which indicates one-way traffic, that they're coming off of two-way in this area. There is another sign located at the southerly end of the Esplanade, which indicates a left turn only. There's another sign located on the northerly part of the southerly end of the Esplanade, which says access limited to municipal vehicles only. Okay. There are four signs clustered in this area. That's maybe a little bit much, but I think that it's probably important that those signs be there. There are two signs which say one way, do not enter. Those are located on both sides of the road. There is an additional sign here that says left turn only. And there's another sign located over in this area that says that it's designated parking lot, public works employees. And at the end of School Drive, at the very, very end of it, there will be a sign that says not a through drive. I think that's important to let people, so they don't start to come in here and then start to fumble around as to where to go. It clearly marks that it's a one-way street, it's not a through street. Any questions?
I think this time, before we get into the board discussion, reopen the public hearing and ask any member of the general public who'd like to address the public hearing. Come forward.
My name is Clint Blood. I live at 63 Hillcrest Road, and I speak with for several concerns about the proposal we have in front of you this evening. One of the things I have a concern with, quite honestly, I live in a 60-year-old house, and you know, you make do when you live in an older house. You know, you don't have master bedrooms or baths off the master bedroom, and you know, things like that. And it seems to me that what we're trying to do is make do with the public works garage and where it's placed. If you were to design a town, you wouldn't put your public works garage right behind the shopping center in between that and the school with all the heavy trucks coming in and out and having about a mile or so away from the sand pit. You wouldn't ever design it that way. So it seems to me like we're making do for cost factors, et cetera, and that perhaps one of the reasons we're doing it is because we want to make it a safe place for our public works people to work. And I certainly would want them to be working in a safe place. There's no question regarding that. But I have a question about if we're trading off the safety of the public works people for the safety of our children. And that really deals with the closure of Jordan Way and or the one-way road in High School Way. The process that we arrived here this evening, I think, is quite interesting. It's, as I understand, it's actually been going on for several years, and that the Municipal Facilities Committee made a recommendation to the Town Council, and the Town Council approved the money for this plan under condition that the Planning Board would approve it. And then, at that point in time, then you asked for a public hearing. Well, it's interesting, after that meeting, your last meeting, I called two principals, I called two school board people, and one athletic director, and they had no idea that the Jordan Way was to be closed. And at the time of your site completion a month ago, it was to close off Jordan Way and allow High School Way to be a two-way street. Since that time, I think there's been a number of meetings that have occurred between the school department and the town, which I certainly am pleased with, and they have come up with a recommendation or experiment, et cetera, to close off High School Way as well as Jordan Way, or to make High School Way one way. But I think that you should be thanked very much for having this to be a public hearing, because if it hadn't been, we wouldn't have had that discussion, at least among our town officials, over the last several weeks. I also think that you're under a lot of political pressure right now to approve this evening. The people who appointed you to the board have already approved it. We have a highly respected town manager and a public works person that I've worked with very closely over the last several years, obviously are in favor of it. The person that you rely upon for your expertise is an employee of the applicant, so to speak. We're really asking the town, it's asking a town to close a town road. And it seems to me we really have to be pretty squeaky clean on this. I'm not suggesting that any of these people have done anything incorrect or et cetera. But if you were a private developer and came forth, probably most everybody here would have to declare themselves, as Tom Emery has, not eligible to vote on this issue. So I think we really have to make sure that we're squeaky clean on this whole thing. One of the concerns I have is, and I don't know, has there been a traffic study done to show the closure of Jordan Way and also the having High School Way go one way? I have a copy of the traffic report that you received, at least at the end of last month's meeting, showing Jordan Way being closed and what the results of that would be. My question is, if in fact this is an experiment, or if we go ahead and do this without having a traffic study, what constitutes failure? Does it require so many cars waiting in line for so many seconds to determine failure at when you get out of the high school? Does it require an accident or a fatality or injury to determine failure? What determines failure? Hopefully it's going to work. I mean, we're always hopeful it's going to work. We also hoped a year ago that we knew how to build a roof, too. And it seems to me that if, in fact, we're looking to do something, we better make sure we're pretty, as I say, squeaky clean on the issue, and we have all of the experts and the reports and the studies done, so that in the event it doesn't work, we can say we've crossed our T's and dotted our I's on each issue, especially when the town is asking a town to close a town road. I think that that's a little different situation here. The other part is, if in fact we go ahead and do this in terms of the experiment or having High School Way closed and it doesn't work, have we precluded the fact that we've allowed the building to be built, that means that Jordan Way has to be closed? If I came before you as a developer and wanted to build a home, and said I thought I could, dig a ditch and have the water run off this property in such a manner, and I went ahead and you said, okay, try it, and I built my house and I dug the ditch, and it didn't work, and the water ran over to somebody else's neighborhood or neighbor, what would happen then? And I guess that's the type of issues that I would ask in terms of if we're really going to preclude this. Because your study that you have in front, or at least the study that I have, shows that just with Jordan Way being closed, not with High School Way being both ways, I show a 45% increase in traffic in the morning, an 83% increase traffic in the afternoon, elementary school is 27% and 60% respectively. And again, the reason I give percentages is the high school right now has the lowest population it probably ever will have. There's about 400 kids in the high school, 100 per class. And we have class sizes in the elementary school that I think are up to 170 or 150 to 170. So we're looking at a 50% increase in our high school in a very short period of time. And I think percentages are important. If, in fact, there's going to be a lot of cars going out of the high school way exit, granted, we have a left and right-hand turn. If you drive there now, we already have a left and right-hand, except you're in the right-hand, you're in the dirt. But people have already done that already. It may mean there may be a traffic light there. And that may be for the safety of everyone. We may have to do that. But we have to understand that that's maybe one of the processes, the end results of what we're deciding tonight. So I would ask that my recommendation would be that I realize you're under a lot of pressure to say yes this evening, but that we should have a traffic study done. We should involve, for example, the parents' groups, the high school, the elementary school, and the middle school, that the town officials are already involved already, that they may come up with the same report. But if we've gone through the process totally, then we can say that we made the best decision with using the best judgments we had in hand. And to me, this evening, unless this has occurred, we really are taking some risk, and those risks really involve our children. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blair. Other members of the public would like to speak?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Janet McLaughlin, 54, Old Colony Lane. I want to speak to you this evening from a number of different perspectives about this project, and I need to assure you and assure the previous speaker that there is no pressure being put on this project from the elected officials in this town just because this project has received some town council approval for funding. We did have a meeting on March 28th, I believe, where a number of town officials, school officials, both elected and staff people, were in attendance. It was said very emphatically at that meeting that this project would be treated in the same manner that any other project would be treated. I see the planner smiling. She knows that was said very emphatically, and that is something we in this town expect the planning board to hold to. That's the expectation, and I know you will fulfill that expectation. One of the issues discussed at that March 28th meeting was the issue of the need for enforcement for the signs that you were discussing earlier this evening that Mr. Stallman presented. A good point of that joint meeting was the town's assurance to the school department, to our designers, that there would be enforcement of these signs. I think this is something we've seen to be a problem currently and in the past, that there may have been signs posted on school property and the enforcement has not happened to the extent that it can happen. This will make it a safer place for all of us and especially for our children. One thing that struck home with me really well at that meeting was hearing from people on the front line, hearing from principals and teachers about what happens when people disregard the traffic control signs on the school property. That's an extension of the project being presented to you, but we are showing some more traffic control signs that do have an impact on the users of the school property, and representing as a town official, I will assure this board, in my capacity as a town official, that the town will see that the signs that are put up are enforced. I think that will help with the safety issues that we all know now exist and any others that may come up because of the proposal before you this evening. I think one concern you may have heard, maybe lingering in your minds, is the issue of safety versus convenience for some of the revisions being proposed to the traffic circulation. And I would put forth to you how hard it is for all of us to change some of the patterns we're used to when we go to the school area I personally have children at the middle school and the high school. I know what it's like to drive between the two schools, go up there at different times of the day, have the convenience of going in Jordan Way, having the access road between the two school complexes be two-way. Again, having heard from those frontline people about the safety concerns, I would wholeheartedly endorse the closing off of Jordan Way to make that a safer place for all of us who are using it. Also support the one-way traffic proposal on the access road between the two school complexes. I think that is going to give us a safer atmosphere for our children. I've heard some of the proposals presented to you by Barry Stallman tonight termed as experiments. I think those of you who have dealt with planning know that it's an evolving process very often, and you need to see how something works. We're talking about some off-site improvements associated with the addition to the Public Works Garage. I think what you're seeing before you is a good example of the applicant, in this case the municipality, working with its neighbors, the neighbors being the school department, and having sat down, held meetings, because you do have public hearings. That's your normal course of events. It's not a special public hearing. It's not a special treatment for this project because it's a municipal project. This is the way the town operates with its planning board, and I think that's one reason you have public hearings at this level. People need to know that. So those are the things I hope you will keep in mind, that we're doing this in cooperation with the town's neighbors, the school department. We're doing this for safety reasons. A lot of the proposals, the changes that have been made since this was last before you, have been made for safety reasons, and then it may be an evolving process. The school department certainly is well aware that they have issues to address on their side. I heard very strong willingness on their part to do that, and I'm sure that the cooperation that has started between the town and the school out of this project will continue for the entire property in that area. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there other members of the public which would like to address? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Connie Goldman. I am a Cape resident, but I am here because I am the interim superintendent of schools. Also recently appointed ongoing superintendent of schools, just to clarify that I should be here when this all happens. Since I have only been in that position for a few months, I can't speak to the what communication may have gone back and forth between the schools and the town planners in the early stages of this project. But I do think I ought to make it clear that the town manager did, in fact, talk to me certainly as long ago as 2 months ago, perhaps slightly longer than that, to alert me to the fact that this was a project that was being looked at, and I want to make it clear that that kind of communication was going on. At the time, I understood from my preliminary conversations with some of the people in the school office that they had, in fact, looked at the problems that might arise in traffic as long ago as a year ago, and had set, at least some of the people in that discussion had set as a priority, that school buses would still be able to go back and forth between the two campuses. And then we also focused some attention on the part of the plan that talks about using the upper high school parking lot, taking a part of that to provide parking for the garage, and I was involved with talking that over with the high school principal, with the business manager. To my knowledge, we have not gone through a process within the school department of talking that over with parents. On the other hand, it is quite evident that there are plenty of parking spaces around the school in a variety of ways, and we saw no real problem with that. Eventually, as I came into the process, I realized that the building administration at the Pond Cove Middle School complex has had some concerns about traffic patterns for a number of years. These concerns, frankly, do not have a lot to do with the project that you are considering, except, of course, any change will impact whatever is going on, and it's hard for us to predict what those changes might be. The concerns they've had for traffic are roughly in two ways. One is the, what appears to be high school traffic, at least it is showing up about the time when high school youngsters driving to school are dismissed from school, so we assume there's some connection there. And that is one that comes up using the access road, frankly, as a throughway to exit at Scott Dyer Road. This has been a longstanding concern in the school department, particularly because going in that direction, traffic goes right by the Pond Cove School where the youngest children are. We do have some occasion to have children cross the mall. Frankly, whether it's through traffic or not, we still have enough internal traffic with close to 1,200 students in that complex so that we have a variety of reasons, cars and trucks of one kind or another coming and going. These are issues, frankly, that we were looking at as possibly being addressed by trying the one-way road. I hear from the people who are there that a major traffic problem for us is traffic coming in the morning. Some of this would be from parents dropping off students or for a variety of it seems to be a major piece of it, but also we have some through traffic going through at about the time that the high school would be, people would be going to the high school. Our thinking when we sat down to at the meetings that Mrs. McLaughlin has talked about is that, frankly, for us, it's an attractive alternative to try to make this a one-way pattern so that traffic going from Scott Dyer to the high school in the morning at a time when we do not have our heaviest concentration of elementary traffic would facilitate going back and forth, and it would still leave the access road open for our buses to travel back and forth between the two campuses, at least one way. As you look at the, as a school superintendent, looking at the problem of the traffic pattern, nobody would build a school with a through road. I mean, that's just a fact. We would not have the high school with a through road. We wouldn't have an elementary complex. This is something that has, in fact, evolved over a period of time. However, what we would be inclined to build with this kind of situation is some kind of internal access road. It does make a lot of sense for us to try to keep our buses out of the major traffic patterns on 77 and Scott Dyer to the extent that we can, and we also have a variety of reasons why we bus children back and forth, sometimes, for instance, for use of the pool, other athletic events, sometimes use of the high school theater and so on. So there are sufficient times when we want to have that internal access, so we would like to have it. In trying to kind of catch up with this process, I have followed at least some attempt to get people involved. We did bring this issue to the joint town and school committee, which was very well attended. It had school board representation as well as the athletic director as well as some of our principals. And although, frankly, none of us have a crystal ball to tell exactly how well these things will go, and I wouldn't want to put myself in that position, we are satisfied that reasonable people have looked at this reasonably. We do not think that we are increasing safety problems, especially if we can try the one-way road. On the other hand, anytime you have any access road, there are some concerns. We also believe that we have some internal traffic problems that we have to straighten out. We are squishing traffic, as I said, for 1,200 students into a very compacted pattern. We do not believe that our parking or the access to parents, the drop-off patterns, so forth, they're not working particularly well, and we take the responsibility of going ahead and studying those things. I did bring this issue also to the last school board meeting. They did not take a vote on it, but they had an opportunity to officially express any opinions they wanted carried by me to this meeting, and essentially felt they are sympathetic to the no clear absolute answers nature of this situation. One board member did raise the issue, could we put another barrier gate on this through road so that we would be able to maintain through traffic for our buses but still close it off and maintain some kind of a barrier so that buses would have mechanical means to use it. Frankly, that had been discussed at our joint meeting, and there were a number of opinions expressing that that would probably be a very hard thing to make sure it was working well for the number of times that the buses need to go back and forth. Nevertheless, I feel I should mention to you that was issued. The board had an opportunity to vote against this project. They did not do it. They have not really formally expressed an opinion one way or the other, but I do think it is fair to say that they have examined it. Our summary conclusions are that we recognize that this is a project that has certainly many worthy aspects to it. We have no desire to simply stand up and oppose it. We would like to be cooperative. We would like to look at our own problems and mesh them with solutions that will perhaps solve what is really a joint problem, and that is right now we have a public throughway through what would normally be built and planned as closed access. I think the public, we see that problem. I assume that's the issue that the safety buildings are looking at. Certainly from a school point of view, we would like to you know, the best of all possible worlds, have closed access to the school campuses but maintain some kind of viable internal access. We don't certainly have any plans to build another road off on the other side of the campus. We obviously can't afford to do that. I know that that's sort of a complicated summary. It's a complicated issue, and I haven't been looking at it long enough to have a real clear 1, 2, 3, 4, but if you had any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you very much. Are there any other members of the public would like to address the public hearing? I urge you to speak if you'd like to, or you have opinion or concern. Seeing and hearing none, I'll officially close the public hearing. This time, I'd invite the applicant back to the podium and a representative of the applicant, and open up the discussion to the planning board to ask questions of the applicant. Judith? Back towards you.
Oh, here I am. Okay. This is, again, I find myself on a, as I frequently do, on two sides of the same fence, it seems, but I am really in favor of the Public Works Garage. I'll just go out and say that right now. That aside, this whole traffic thing has just got me all akimbo here. Just verify for me what's coming. You're going to have traffic that's going to go around the middle school and the elementary school, but you can still go down to the high school through High School Way, right?
That's correct. And what?
And if you are a school bus or a snow plow or something else, a cruiser or a municipal vehicle, you can go up the wrong way. No.
No.
Well, then how are they going to get into the place where they get their gas?
They have to come this way.
That's Northerly Passage, though.
That from the bus garage, they can come in the controlled access way.
Where you'll have a gate now.
There's a gate. They can come in that lane down. They could come down. They're coming from the bus garage anyway. This is one way, and they can come down that way and get in. But they can't come up. It's one way going this way.
Absolutely. What, now, how are the school buses going to get back and forth? See, that's the way I thought it was going to be, was that it was all one way. Now I seem to hear wrinkles that, oh, no, that there's special concerns, you can go backwards. And
No.
There's absolutely no going north between those two points.
Right at this point, you can go no further. From here down, it's two way.
It's two, okay, yeah, I got that.
From there down. And that's what the signage, I think if you read the signage,
mm-hmm.
it should... That's what it should say.
Well, that's what I thought it was, and then until I started to hear other things that I think I have a fairly linear mind. This is.
Judith, Bill Bray is here, the traffic engineer. Any questions specifically of him that might help? Part of the problem is we don't have a picture of the entire campus area to see the overall flow from Scott Dyer Road down to 77.
It's essentially two, and this is sort of a free-for-all in here.
No fooling.
I know, the problem is we can't right. Necessarily envision that.
it's a free-for-all with that, with it, just as it is. It's I guess there's a part of me that wants to say, okay, the school department thinks it's okay, and I'm presuming that they've got my kids and everybody else's best interest. I'm terrified of another Shaw's Plaza with stripes and signs and this is and that's and everybody going nowhere. With nobody knows where to stop, nobody knows to go, where to stop or go or. And this, and the other thing I'm having a hard time overcoming is what someone else brought up, which is you're getting used to doing something. I'm used to driving that road a certain way for 17 years, and now you're going to do it differently. And what do you really think? I'm not having problems with this.
There's always a learning process or a transitional period of time to, as you indicated, to go from what you're accustomed to doing to something new. In a lot of cases, what you may actually have to do on a temporary basis is add additional signs, and especially with the majority of the traffic school-oriented, I'm not saying all of it necessarily school-bound traffic, but the majority of the traffic is school-oriented. You know, it may be something that the school departments in the two different school buildings may want to send out some sort of an informational letter to the students that they could either have for themselves or take home to the parents if the parents are dropping or picking students up, which would help at least get people accustomed to the changes that are being recommended. As Barry had indicated before, we've recommended a lot of different signs throughout the entire facility, which with the enforcement that's been discussed by the city councilor, it should actually improve the safety through that area, because presently I can assure you that a 15-mile-an-hour school zone certainly is not abided by along that roadway, and I have recommended the signs throughout the entire roadway area. Again, if they're enforced, the safety should be actually better than what it is today.
I'm afraid of people cutting over across the top, coming down Jordan Way, down and around.
Coming down Jordan Way.
Yeah, and then taking a left there and scooting through.
That's, you know, there's always the potential of that happening. You know, there's nothing that you can design that's absolute. That's strictly an enforcement issue that will have to be dealt with by the police department. And assuredly, for the first week, 2 weeks that this is implemented, there will be people that will find every possible shortcut that there is to try to circumvent the changes. But once it's all ironed out, those changes should, as I say, enhance the safety in both of the school properties.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Any other questions? Other board members? Janet?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to hear from Mr. Bray about whether he has done any study of the access, of the intersection of Route 77 and the access road to the high school.
Yes, as part of my original study, and possibly it would be appropriate to sort of answer one of the previous speaker's comments, there was a second study completed at the request of the town manager for the changes in the circulation. And in both cases, I looked at the impact of the high school driveway at Route 77. And I've recommended, and it is part of the proposed plan, that the access driveway leading at Route 77 be widened to provide an exclusive left and a right turn lane as it leaves the high school property. And something in the, and it's certainly something you can't predict 100%, But it may even be something in the very long-range future that the town may want to consider putting a left turn lane out on Route 77, not only for the high school property, but also for the shopping center. This is something that would be in the long-range future of the area. But that was considered, and it was evaluated under both studies.
Were there any numerical evaluations of the increase in the traffic or percentage increase based on this reconfiguration of the roadway?
Yes, I'm not sure if the planning board members have a copy of my letter that I sent to the town planner, which reevaluated the traffic study. In that, I indicated that during the morning hour or the morning rush hour into the school, there would be 46 additional trips added to the high school entrance. And in the evening hour, there would be 80 trips additional than what's there today added to those to that intersection. And in both cases, you know, I've looked at the capacity of the intersection. Keep in mind that the peak hour of the school does not correspond to the peak hour of traffic along Route 77. But in both cases, there is adequate capacity at the intersection to accommodate the additional traffic diverted by the closing of Jordan Way.
Judy?
I just have one question. In the memo we got from our town planner that included our town engineer's comments, he indicates some doubt whether the 100-foot-long left-turn storage bay is adequate, since there obviously will be a lot more traffic and more buses going through, and I didn't know what you thought about that.
Well, it's my understanding, talking with Barry, that has been lengthened to include the entire length of the raised island that separates the ingress and egress points of the high school, which I believe provides close to 300 feet of feet for the left turn lane. If anything, it's over-designed, but it certainly is not going to hurt anything.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions?
Yeah, a couple of questions.
Mm-hmm.
Was it ever considered that a section of High School Way be closed up near the end of middle school, so there was no traffic through that roadway at all, except municipal traffic coming in from Jordan Way, so we could just sort of make it an island and separate the two schools so they wouldn't have to worry about trucks and buses going through?
I'm not certainly aware of all the conversations that have taken place in the past on this, but I know that we discussed at length closing this entire access through there versus leaving it as it originally was designed with two-way access. And because of the problems of not having the circulation between the two schools with the school buses, it was felt that it would be better designed if it was allowed to operate as a one-way circulation pattern versus closing it entirely to the through traffic. And that was discussed at considerable length. And the consensus was it was better to leave it one way than it was to close it completely off. And it was mainly because the school, you know, fought the access needs for the bus circulating between the two schools was very important. And at least with one-way flow, you have at least the access in one direction.
Okay, and also in the copy of the letter that you sent to our town planner, on the third page, and I don't know if this was just a mistake, but maybe you could answer. Okay. Right.
Excuse me, that was a page that was substituted for an earlier submission.
I was reading that, and I just sort of stopped in mid-sentence, so I guess we're all set.
Other questions? I have a few. For Mr. Bray, in your letter of April 1, which I think you're referring to as the update, you say in the first paragraph, furthermore, traffic will only be allowed to travel one way northerly within this section. My understanding from the plan is that it's supposed to be southerly. Were your calculations done from a northerly traffic flow or a southerly traffic flow?
My calculations, and maybe I misplaced north for south, but my calculations were completed assuming that one way was to take place this way.
Does it make a difference for traffic flow if it were reversed to a northerly flow?
It would be difficult for me to give you a complete answer to that without sitting down and recalculating the numbers.
I tried to do that.
There's so much. Well, it's very difficult.
We got partway through it. But
there's a great deal of internal traffic that takes place in the parking lot. And if you go back to my original report on the figure one, which showed the existing traffic counts that we made within the complex, a lot of that traffic is internal to the site. And without sitting down and trying to go back through the numbers, I can't tell you for sure whether it's better or worse in particular direction. Although I do know that once we looked at it, it would be my opinion that the one-way flow is actually better than what the original plan was of two-way flow.
Is the one-way with a southerly flow the best alternative?
If I could just answer, in terms of the high school, we felt it was, because it's not bringing high school kids coming up through the complex and getting up in where the younger children are, and it was far better to head them in the opposite direction.
Except for in the early morning traffic, if they come from that from the westerly side of town, does the cut through? I have an overall concern for this entire campus situation, and I voiced that a month ago. I believe, and I can't put my finger on right now, you mentioned 15 mile an hour, maybe it was our town engineer, I'm sorry, 15 mile an hour signs, and the speed limit signs were not mentioned, my understanding, on any of the site that you've proposed, any speed limit signs at all? They weren't, I didn't see them in the most recent drawing that I had.
We did install some signs last week, one on High School Way and up in the middle school area that state 15 mile an hour speed limit, and they are being enforced.
Has the town given consideration for the blinking, the lighted 15 mile an hour school in session type, and I can't, again, I think it's not Mr. Bray, but the town engineer mentioned that we're getting to that level of traffic flow.
I think it's been recommended in the traffic study, but no further work has been done on it. You're talking up on Scott Dyer Road?
Mm-hmm. Also on 77.
Yeah.
But there's nothing in the plans?
There are no plans to do that at the present time.
Okay. One more question for Mr. Bray. I think your intent when you did this update was that for southerly flow?
Yes,
take it the northerly, just
yes, it was.
Typo.
My error.
I'm sorry, one more question. I can't leave you alone. In the conclusions, page 6, when you change this page, the previous number 5 is removed. I have too many papers here. And the previous number 5 states the closure of Jordan Way will also impact traffic patterns on Route 77, Shore Road, Scott Dyer intersection, roughly 54 trips in the AM and so forth. That paragraph is removed from your conclusions. Can you tell us why that was removed?
The reason was that the actual change in traffic at the intersection was so meaningless that with the one-way change that I didn't feel that it was that important to include it as a conclusion. As I stated in the letter, the change with the one-way circulation only alters the traffic in the morning by 10 additional trips, and in fact in the evening hour it actually reduces traffic by 2 vehicles.
I thought we just went over the changes on Route 77, and this paragraph addresses that. That you said there were 80-some-odd changes in the AM?
Okay, I thought the other planning board member had asked about the high school driveway in Route 77, and number 5 speaks about Route 77, Shore
at
Road.
Shore Road?
Yeah.
That in? Okay.
Right.
Okay. So what you're saying is that the reason for the removal of that paragraph is that it doesn't impact the traffic patterns at that intersection?
That's right. It has very, very little impact at all at the intersection.
Okay. One area, and it seems to be an unlighted area. And from all the drawings I've looked at, there's no lighting on the would be the southwesterly bay, which is created by the new addition. You've got flush mounted on the south side of the garage and flush mounted on the west side of the addition. But you've got a big black area there that's fairly significant. Now will be bordered by trees on this side. Are we creating a black hole there for a great place to hang out? I spotted it right away.
Over here. Yeah.
Now.
Right, there is a pole located.
Nope. Give him that behind. Yes, right in there. That corner.
In here.
Mm-hmm. Shows no lighting at all.
There's existing lighting on the existing building.
Okay, so it's on the existing building, is this?
That's correct. That's why we're mentioning it.
Okay. Question on the drainage. And I noticed you had earlier some arrows and so forth. From the old plan to the new plan, we seem to be adding a little bit of drainage into the back of the shopping center. I know that was not a highly sophisticated study, but we asked you to do some points of elevation.
Okay.
Right. That's the new design's up there.
I'm going to do it this way because...
Okay.
The existing... Here. When I was here last, someone asked the question about drainage district. It was a lot of it goes in the ball field. Well, I was in here when we made that statement. We went back that night and looked at it. You get a much better picture actually at nighttime. There is right along here, there's a slight kick up on the existing pavement. And it does flow, all the drainage from this area flows down to this catch basin located here. And we're really not going to change much of that pattern, although we're taking probably less water to that catch basin and diverting some over into this area. I don't believe there's really any more water being added to the back of the IGA. We're not doing any changing of topography in this area, nor are we changing any of the grass strip between.
But you're showing a new arrow of drainage.
Yeah, that's what it does, will do, and that's what it does now. There should be another arrow over there. It's not changing, we're not changing that at all.
It looked like more drainage going on at the back of that property. Any other questions from the board?
Mr. Chairman, do I understand that Bob Malley has no concerns about, or is that the drainage as indicated is going to be acceptable to the Public Works Department? Okay. I just wanted to, Mr. Chairman, ask one question of the applicant, and that is, I assume the applicant is familiar with Fred Morin's letter of April the 8th with some suggestions about what needs to be done with respect to the plan. Have you had a copy of that letter?
Yes, we have.
Particularly with respect to page one of that letter, I don't necessarily have to go down it bit by bit as long as I understand that you have had a chance to review the letter and have no difficulty with the suggestions made by Mr. Morin.
We have gone down through each of those items. The details will be shown when the final working drawings are produced.
Okay.
For both the layout of obviously all of the radii and layout drawings for the new roadways, as well as for the island construction. And any other details that have been omitted at this point will be turned in for so that they can be looked at prior to building permits being issued.
Okay, then I just have one last question, and that has to do with the buffering. You're showing on the landscaped island, the curved island that goes by the side of the new addition, 20 Austrian pines and a couple of crab apples, is that right?
There are two crab apples located right here.
Okay.
And those are an upright crab, pink flowering.
And then how?
The rest are the pines.
And the pines will be on the lower portion?
From here to there. From there to there. And the other plantings, there will be the Rosa rugosa or sea rose between the employee parking lot and the high school parking lot.
What's the spacing of the trees roughly with respect to the distance covered along that space?
It's pretty dense. They're 15 feet on center. And they have a good spread and they will grow.
Uh-huh.
And they're right from approximately 20 to 25 feet away from the crab. And then they'll be spaced every 15 feet. I think they should be more than adequate and
mm-hmm.
create a very good buffer.
Thank you.
Other questions?
One last quick question. Has any consideration been given to maybe putting some speed bumps in just to slow traffic down coming from the upper part?
The issue of speed bumps has been discussed, and because it's been looked at, and really from a liability point of view, it can be a tremendous problem just with front ends, and if someone is speeding, and you know, the town could be liable for damages done to vehicles. And it would, I believe the town attorney looked at it at one point, and it was recommended that they should not be placed on public roads. You will see them in trailer parks and amusement parks, but on public throughways, I believe it's recommended not to have them. And strictly for a liability point of view, they do work, but liability-wise, they're not very functional.
Thank you.
Tim?
I have a question about the stormwater run from the project. I appreciate the fact that the revival project will not increase the runoff. Doesn't really increase the impervious surface to a great extent. But what's the current situation now with stormwater runoff? Where does it go, and is there any treatment at all of any oil that happens to enter into the stormwater runoff from the garage area?
Right now there is no treatment, and part of the proposal is to install an oil and water separator for our floor drains to catch that material.
Where would that be installed?
That would be installed.
What about this area right here? I think there is a drawing of it.
Not with us. You have a drawing of it.
What about this area?
Of it on the second sheet of Sebago Technics drawing. There is a drawing of the oil-water separator.
It's right in that dark area.
I think it's on your first page. But it's a device that will catch oil and sand material.
So where did the
right now, the current flow ends up in a drainage swale that runs down the back road of the high school. There's a large ditch that runs between the road itself and an athletic field, and that eventually finds its way into the marsh down in back of Elizabeth Park.
So the new project would increase the treatment of the runoff?
Yes, it would.
Jen, you look like you have a question.
I really have a motion to propose if we've have no further discussion. I don't want to rush the matter.
Maureen?
I just wanted to point out that in the suggested motion and the report to the board, the reference to section 19.315 is incorrect and should be deleted.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I propose the following motion for the planning board to consider. Findings of fact as follows. One, that the applicant wishes to construct a 2,631 square foot office addition to the Public Works Garage located on Jordan Way. Two, that this development requires site plan review under section 19-2-9. Third, that the application was certified as complete at the March 19, 1991 meeting of the planning board. Fourth, there are construction details which should be resolved on the plans prior to the construction of the project. Five, a sidewalk proposed at the corner of the Public Works Garage extends onto an abutter's property. Six, that revisions to the submitted plans could violate the site plan regulations. Seventh, that no parking is designated for the handicapped visitors to the Public Works facility. And eighth, that the applicant has substantially addressed the standards of the site plan regulations. Propose the following decision. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for site plan approval of a 2,631 square foot office addition to the existing Public Works Garage located on Jordan Way be granted, according to section 19-2-9 and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. One, that revised plans be promptly submitted to the town engineer and town planner that address the concerns raised on page one of the April 8, 1991 letter from the town engineer prior to construction. Two, that the applicant request permission from Gendon Commercial Brokers to install a sidewalk on their property with the understanding that if such permission is denied, that the sidewalk will be deleted. Third, that handicapped parking spaces be designated on the site plan. And fourth, that any changes to the approved plans and materials shall be referred to the planning board for review and approval prior to construction.
We have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion as read, raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Have your site plan approval. Thank you. We're running behind schedule right now, and our next order of old business is the article of daycare amendments to the zoning ordinance sections 19-1-3 and 19-2-2. Expediting review of day nurseries limited to 6 children, public hearing, recommendation to the town council. I'll ask to briefly introduce this before the public hearing. Perhaps our town planner can just quickly bring us up to speed.
The amendments before you were suggested upon the belief that the existing process for receiving approval for a daycare home of up to 6 children, that the degree of development for that type of use didn't need the type of review that was currently receiving. Right now, if you want to open up a daycare for up to 6 children, you must go to the Zoning Board of Appeals for a conditional use permit and then to the Planning Board for site plan review. The amendment before you would allow someone who wanted to open up a daycare for up to 6 children in their own home to instead apply for a use permit from the building inspector. If that operator were to meet the following criteria, which are that they not operate before 7 a.m. or after 7 p.m., they provide an outdoor play area, that they allow no outside play before 9 a.m. on Sundays, Saturdays, and holidays, and that they provide adequate lighting for pickup and drop-off areas. And if there was no complaint received within 30 days from abutters, that a use permit could be issued. This amendment also provides definitions for day nursery, which isn't currently defined, and also for a daycare home, which would be any kind of facility providing daycare for children that would be more extensive than six children taken care of in an operator's residence. So those are the amendments before you.
Okay. I'd like to call the public hearing to order. Encourage any members of the public who would like to address comments or concerns about the article before us. As I've indicated before, approach the podium and introduce yourself. Try to keep your comments brief, if possible. Are there any members of the public who would like to address the public hearing? I guess seeing none and hearing none, I will close the public hearing. Open it to discussions of the planning board. Any comments and concerns? Any further questions on the amendments?
Town planner, I just had one, and perhaps it was because I read this too late at night. It seems to me that the definition of day nursery might be nicer if it would literally precede on the page the definition of daycare home, because day nursery is the more confined something, and then the daycare home is basically everything else. But I understand that in alphabetical order, they go like this, and if that's what the rule is, no big deal. That really is truly and literally the extent of my comments.
Thank you, Janet. It was late at night. Any other questions or comments? Do I hear a motion? Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, be it ordered that the Planning Board recommends to the Town Council the amendments to the Zoning Ordinance Section 19-1-3 and 19-2-2, expediting review of day nurseries limited to six children.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
A slight amendment to the order. Be limited to six children or fewer.
Is that an acceptable amendment to the...
Six or fewer children.
That's fine. Okay. Any other discussion? As amended, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Next order of business, the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision, request by Peter Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group for a 20-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Channel View Road, Hunts Point Road Extension, and Two Lights Road, final subdivision review, section 16-2-4. I'd like to ask the applicant to come to the podium and briefly.
Mr. Chairman, I have to excuse myself due to bias for this particular discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. I will appoint Judy Lardner as a voting member on this article. The representative, the applicant, could briefly bring us up to speed over the last 30 days. We'd appreciate it.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Paul Frinsko here on behalf of Greater Portland Development Group. With me this evening are Mr. and Mrs. Kennedy and Scott Decker of Squaw Bay, the engineers. Let me just cover a couple of issues. I believe that in the last 30 days, the only change which you have seen is the recipient of the pedestrian easement and the conservation land. We have proposed that that be conveyed through the Conservation Commission by statute to the town of Cape Elizabeth. Having public control over those facilities was a relief to Mr. Kennedy, and I have worked with both Tom Leahy and Mike Hill, and I believe that we have agreed on the final terms and conditions of the two deeds. You should by now have the final letter of credit together with a memorandum from the town manager approving the letter of credit based upon the approval of the town attorney. I have consulted with Mr. Hill and Mr. Leahy. The final letter of credit has been approved. This evening we're here. Chairman, is there any question about receipt of those documents? Because they were delivered. I hope you have them.
The letter of credit was not with the packet that was sent to the planning board members.
I don't know why not, but I have Mr. McGovern's memorandum. I can show you my copy. It went to your town planner. I have Mr. Leahy's approval. It came over my fax this afternoon.
In the correspondence at the beginning of the meeting, I referred to a letter from Mr. Leahy dated today on his comments on the letter of credit.
Right.
The letter of credit was not with the packet that sent out to the board members.
I can't answer that question. That's an internal question that you'll have to resolve.
Okay.
We're here this evening to answer any questions that board members may have. The plan you have before you is essentially the identical plan you had before you at the time you granted preliminary approval, with the exception of the road location in Phase 1.
Thank you. At the end of last meeting, last month, a number of questions were raised and asked of the applicant after the public hearing. We did receive more information in our packet this month. At this time, I'd like to ask the planning board if they have more questions, comments, or concerns. We're approaching a final decision to be made. It's always been my opinion, and continues to be as the chairperson of this board, that we have the right and the duty to request the best that we can for this town in reviewing an application. Other questions from the board members?
I have two issues, Mr. Chairman, that in case anybody has any lingering doubts that I'd like to clear up at the appropriate time.
Would the board like to hear those issues now?
You've raised them, so I want to clear them up.
Go ahead.
The first has to do with the easement to Central Maine Power Company. The best way to explain this is that when Mr. Balfour, a predecessor in title, a couple of owners back, planned a development across a portion of this land, he planned a road, and he granted an easement to Central Maine Power Company. The purpose of that easement, and it was a temporary easement, was to allow for the utility's correction of a problem with power in Broad Cove. The utility installed a line in there, knowing full well that that line would be relocated. I have a letter which we received from Central Maine Power Company that confirms this, but if you have the letter of credit, and I had hoped you had, it will have an attachment on it showing the schedule of work and the utilities that are included in that letter of credit. One of the items of utility work is the installation of a new and substitute power line through the road in Phase 1. In other words, what will occur is that when the new road is built, Central Maine Power Company will install a brand new cable in that road and then will terminate the existing service in the old easement and we will terminate the easement. We did not want to terminate the easement, which we have the right to do, until such time as the new road is built, for obvious reasons. But I wanted to give you the Central Maine Power Company's confirmation.
I guess the problem we've had, it has not been a part of the plan, and it's not a part of the plan tonight.
Well, it's always been shown on the plans in your possession, since it is temporary. The original survey showed that plant, that road, and the easement.
In our final plan?
No, it does not show on the final plan, since it's a temporary easement. It does now, at your request, we put it on the final plan. But since it's temporary, it's going to be eliminated, and it'll be eliminated before the town takes title of the property. The second is a question which was raised in the planner's memorandum relative to the lot designations on the HHE 200 forms. As you will recall, the original plan that came into you at the time the HHE 200s were submitted had a different lot designations. The soils engineer has clarified that and has told you which lot numbers to use for which HHE 200 forms, and I have that letter from the soil engineer also.
The problem, and of course I haven't had any chance to take a look at this letter from Mr. Farah, is that the question that I had before was that what is now, I believe, Lot 2, it's south of the proposed road, the septic system chamber system location is in a different location than the previous plan. And nowhere in any of the plans that I have show any test pits or give any reference to that. I asked the town building inspector, Mr. McBain, if he had record of it. He had record of the change in lot numbers. That was easy enough to follow. But the change in location of the chamber system, all of a sudden it appeared in a different location.
Okay, no well, reference. Mr. McBain, Mr. Kennedy, Mr. Decker have conferred. Mr. Decker is here this evening to answer any questions you have about the location of those systems. I don't feel comfortable.
The only question I would have is we need to see a copy of the HHE 200 for that site. I don't question the fact that you moved it. That's fine. It's in a new, better location than it was, but we simply don't have anything to look at.
Whenever you'd like to get to that issue, Mr. Chairman, we have someone here to respond.
Fine. Are those the two issues?
Those are the two I wanted to make sure there were no questions about.
Any questions from the board? Just as a matter of concentration on tonight's application, I'm not going to ask. It's up to the planning board. It's very distracting to receive information at the time of carrying on the article before us. We do review what has been submitted to us at that time. Any questions of the planning board members?
Mr. Chairman, Janet? I'd like to start perhaps framing the review of this by going back, Mr. Frinsco, to the conditional approval of the preliminary subdivision plan about a year ago, and just reviewing just briefly with perhaps myself and the other board members just where we are on those old conditions before we get to the more recent things.
Go right ahead, Mr. Kyle. I'm not ignoring you. I'm going to go pull my minutes.
By all means, and I'll certainly allow you time to do that.
No, please go ahead.
All right. Paragraph A says that all lands proposed for the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust ownership shall be accepted by the land trust, and that written proof of said acceptance shall be provided prior to the submission of the final plan. Now, as I understand it, the land trust is not accepting any of the land that a year ago was indicated for them, but that the recommendation is that the town accept that plan. Do we have agreement?
Not quite.
Okay, then please.
The land trust is not accepting it because they were concerned as a private charitable organization about the enforcement obligation.
Mm-hmm.
The Conservation Commission, on behalf of the town, which by statute has the authority to accept property on behalf of the town for these purposes, has agreed to accept that. You have a letter from the Conservation Commission chairman acknowledging and confirming that fact.
Do we have...
In other words, it went to you folks. I got a copy of it.
No, no, I have a copy of that letter in my packet. My question has to do, and perhaps it's a question for the town planner rather than you, as to whether or not we need any further indication from the town attorney that the proposed restrictions are acceptable to the town.
Town attorney's present.
The town attorney, Michael Hill, is here if you would like.
Our office has reviewed the deeds that were submitted. We asked Mr. Frinsco to make one change regarding one of the restrictions, which would have placed responsibility for enforcement of the drainage easements and other restrictive covenants, but would have reserved the right of the grantor to step in and enforce the restrictive covenants if they felt the town was not properly enforcing them, and also charge those costs to the town. That has been agreed by Mr. Frinsco to be removed from the warranty deed, which, if you have the deed in front of you, it's paragraph 6, I believe, of the warranty deed, which will be removed.
We can readily do that. We simply don't want to... We don't want to place a burden on the town, but we don't want to prohibit someone from independently enforcing those covenants if, in fact, they need to be enforced. They are given for the benefit of the town and for the benefit of the homeowners who will eventually live there.
Mr. Hill, have you explored on behalf of the town the feasibility of simply having the land retained and have easements in favor of the town as an alternative to having the town actually have the land and take the land off the tax rolls?
No, we have not. My thought is, I believe that the town council preference, I may be wrong, is to take the property in fee, but we have not been asked, nor have we done anything on that.
Okay.
Maureen?
In reviewing the records from the previous preliminary approval of this project, it was originally discussed with the planning board of having a conservation easement over that land, and it was the preference of the board at that time that the land be given in fee to a third party instead of a conservation easement. I believe that's why we're at the point we're at now.
Thank you. That was something I had forgotten. Michael. B of the conditions was that the pedestrian easement crossing the southern portion of the site be situated in a manner allowing for pedestrian access that does not intrude on the identified endangered or threatened plants and that is passable by pedestrians on a year-round basis. The easement to be in form and location acceptable to the town planner. Is that something which we can cross off the list?
That easement was checked by the previous town planner, was found to be passable. However, that's now in the land that is going to be donated in fee, so there is no specific pedestrian easement. It's part of the land to be donated on the southern part of the gravel road.
Okay. C was that all pedestrian easements shall be clearly identified on the final plan and that the legal documentation and all other arrangements concerning the dedication of the easements to the town shall be prepared by the applicant, reviewed by the town attorney and the town manager prior to the submission. Those conditions have been met?
Yes, we've reviewed the easement deed that goes through the phase two, the northern section. The plan adequately depicts the easement, and the legal description of the attached to the easement deed is adequate.
There was some concern, as I remember, that was raised at the last meeting with respect to the distance between the pedestrian easement and the land that was going to be public land. Peter Rand, I think, testified that he thought there was as much as 100-foot variation and was concerned about access from the pedestrian easement to the adjacent public land or the non-adjacent public land. Did you address that issue at all in your review?
No, we didn't. The easement does connect with the land that is proposed to be donated to the town. At some points, though...
Several points.
Yes, at several points. But at some points, it is not adjacent to... I don't know if that's a concern to you or not, but the easement itself is actually destroyed.
Right. Okay. Condition D was that all proposed lots shall have building envelopes designated on the final plan that adequately indicate the land area within which any development activity will be permitted. Maureen, is there some concern about that with respect to septic systems?
All the lots now have building envelopes indicated on them. There was a concern with whether development activity included septic systems. There was a determination that septic systems did, in fact, was development activity.
Mm-hmm.
The applicant has now mostly reflected the building envelope for all the lots, which includes septic systems. There is an existing sanitary disposal system for the farmhouse, which is not reflected in the building envelope. That is an existing building. So there may be some questions about how effective the building envelope is in that particular lot. I think there was another issue raised that some of the septic system locations, which are shown within building envelopes, intrude upon the buffer areas. But as far as I'm aware, all the building envelopes show include the septic system, and the notes in the plans that originally excluded septic systems from development activity have now been revised so that if you want to put in a septic system, you have to put it within the building envelope. It's not an accepted activity outside the building envelope.
The point, just to add to the point that I made at last month's meeting, was that the applicant simply moved the building envelope to include all the septic systems, which I stated as one board member wasn't acceptable to me. He was simply moving the buffer area away because he, for some reason, chose not to move the septic system area just to eliminate the buffer area and draw a line around that to include it in the building envelope.
Any other comments on D from anybody?
I would just, with respect to the septic system on the farmhouse lot, it seems that...
That's proposed.
It is. It goes, there's one plan that goes around it.
Yeah. What you have in the final plan is a proposed new system if needed. As the property is being developed, it is not proposed to replace the existing system, which is not shown in the plan.
Okay. Maybe I've just looked at too many of these over 2 years.
And they all look pretty much alike.
They all start to, really. But
I understand that.
I guess I'm looking at the final subdivision phase one, which doesn't show the little jog around it. Yet when you look at the general site plan, it does have it, the little jog. And I guess I'm presuming...
From this package?
This one?
Final phase one from that package. Pardon me?
Do you see what I mean?
Yeah, the proposed replacement system, if needed, is not shown on the little plan you have.
Nor is it shown on, what's C, is it drawing C 100A?
I think that's the plan you're looking at, isn't it? Yes.
I'm looking at, well, I'm looking at C-100, C-100A, and C-101.
Right.
I just, I've got everybody with their plans.
Now, let me just find out what the number of the plan is that you should be looking at.
Yeah, that's, tell me that, and then I'll look at that one.
C-101.
C-101, the detail.
C-101. That has the little, okay.
Yeah.
The, it's proposed?
General site plan.
Okay.
It's a future replacement system.
Okay.
The existing system, although it need not be shown on the plan, is adjacent to the northeasterly, most northeasterly, most northerly corner of the house.
Okay.
I believe that system's been reviewed by your LPI, your local plumbing inspector also.
I have a question, I guess, because the plan that I see hasn't changed or hasn't moved the buffers back to the dimensions that it could ask for or I had asked for. Why the applicant chose not to do that?
Why?
To not to move the...
They didn't move to where you asked them to move
yes.
to. Well, I can't speak for the applicant. I can tell you that I don't believe it's required by the ordinance, and I believe it's a major engineering undertaking, and that plan was approved by the planning board in May of last year. But there may be an engineering reason that Scott Decker would like to share with us.
No, it's not a specific engineering reason. It's just that we felt it was clear at the preliminary approval stage that the septic systems where they were shown were acceptable. In fact, the question was asked, and we said...
I guess I was the only one that voted that they weren't.
That's right.
Well, that may be.
And I think the intent was at the time that we spent a significant amount of time talking about the buffered area and around between lots. To be 15 feet or a total of 30 between the lots,
right.
And for some reason decided not to move the septic systems. It was your choice to include septic systems as something that was legitimate to intrude on the buffer space.
Well, it was our impression.
I made it quite clear that at least as one planning board, that was not the intent of the buffer area.
Yeah, I understand. But going back and reviewing the minutes of the meeting, it was clear in my mind anyway that it was an understood that they would be within the area shown on the drawings, and that we were to revise the building envelope so that they'd be included in the building envelope.
I'll quote from Mr. Frinsko's letter of March 25th. It says on page 12, paragraph 4, Mr. Etzel asked...
What year, Mr. Etzel?
1991.
91, the brand new?
The brand new stuff, right. On page 12, paragraph 4, Mr. Etzel asked for a point of clarification as to whether there's... In condition D, if the land area within which any development activity will be permitted includes septic systems because a number of the chamber systems are located in the buffer area. The question was not about the land itself. The question was, are septic systems considered to be building activity? The answer was yes. And that was the only point made at that point. Your stating of it here lends itself towards that my comment or question had to do about the land itself.
My
question had to do with, is a septic system considered building activity? The answer to that was yes.
I don't find a letter from me of March 12th, Mr.
March
Chairman.
25th, I said.
25th?
Yes. In your most, the March 29th submission, final
Is it
review?
My letter or is it somebody else's letter? Let me just be sure of.
Sorry? Signed by Peter Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy's letter.
Okay. I will,
sorry, Mr. Prince.
Going through my file saying, where did I, my secretary put that letter?
I know.
Preliminary.
Page 4.
Yeah, I think if, do you happen to have the minutes of
yes,
the...
Yes, I do.
May Is it 15? I think Ms. McCarr was reading from them. And if you look at page...
12.
Right below J. Right below J.
I'm not there yet.
Yes, that's correct. Page 12, right below J.
Is it 12?
Yes.
I know that.
Okay, mine aren't numbered, so thank you very much. Let me just make a note of that.
Mr. Edsel then asked for a point of clarification as to whether in condition D, if the land area within which any development activity will be permitted, quote-unquote, includes septic systems because a number of the chamber systems are located in the buffer area, the answer was yes.
And the important thing in that paragraph is where the quotation marks are. It simply quotes from the condition, starts at the land and ends at will be permitted.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman?
Yes, certainly.
As a follow-up on that point, on the applicant's notes, septic systems are defined as an activity within a building envelope, and activities outside a standard building envelope do not include septic systems. So let me ask a question of the town planner. Is this building envelope included, or is it defined as part of the building setback line from property lines?
Yeah.
Plus other setback requirements from wetlands and so forth.
No, there's nothing. There may be setback requirements from wetlands for septic systems, which I assume the setbacks in these plans meet. There is nothing in our ordinance that has a specific zoning setback for septic systems from property lines. So that. The issue that Mr. Edsel was trying to bring up is that the argument was that everything would be set back 15 feet from the property line, all construction activity. However, those building envelopes were subsequently revised for some of the lots because the septic systems were not set back 15 feet.
Well, is the term building envelope a legal term, and does it have a minimum setback requirement?
The term building envelope refers to the particular plan you're talking about. If someone were to come in and ask for a building permit and try to build their house in an area that was where the septic system was intended to be and it didn't meet the current setback requirements, then they would not be able to build a house there. But the building envelope is that term is defined for just this project. If you came in for a building permit, then there would be another definition for a building envelope. But there are places on this plan where you might be able to meet the setback requirements, but according to this plan, you would not be able to place a building because the building envelope has been drawn strictly in that case. Does that answer your question?
It's not a defined term.
The second question, then. Are these septic systems located any closer than 10 feet to the property line?
Yes.
They are located closer than 10
feet? Lot 12 and 13, in fact, yes.
No.
Well, there's no legal description of the change between lots 12 and 13.
If you have a 40-scale plan, if you pull out your 40-scale plan, you will find that there is no septic system within 10 feet of the property line. Very difficult to scale out here.
Is there a legal description of the easement given between lots 12 and 13?
Where?
I don't know, anywhere. Submitted a legal, some type of legal description of the easement required between lots 12 and 13 in phase two.
Hang on a second.
I
don't know what you mean by easement. That's the what I'm, you threw me off, Mr. Edsel.
I'm referring to a town engineer's comment.
Through the chair?
Yes.
The original septic system report submitted by the applicant indicated that an easement will be required between lots 12 and 13 in phase two because there's a state requirement that septic systems must be a minimum of 10 feet away from property lines. Subsequent to the submission of that septic system information, the applicant has revised the location of the property line between lot 12 and 13 so that 10-foot requirement is now met, and the applicant has most recently submitted, I believe he submitted, a new letter from his septic system evaluator which recognizes the change in the lot line and that an easement is no longer needed. So as that, I understand,
easement never was needed. I think your engineer suggested it may be needed. No, it wasn't
the
needed.
The applicant's
letter indicated that it was needed. From what I understand from the applicant, the lot line was subsequently adjusted between those two lots so that the septic system is at least 10 feet away from the other lot.
That's the final plan shows that, yes,
yes.
Ma'am.
Is that on a plan more recent than the 2191 of C-105?
It's on the 2191 plan.
I believe the problem was that the applicant's original letter from his septic system evaluator was not updated after the lot line was adjusted, so that the current plans you have before you should meet the state requirement.
Is that change in the plan something which needs to go back to DEP?
No.
Wasn't that where the lot line was when you submitted the application to DEP?
Nothing has changed. DEP has reviewed this and compared it to the state code. The Department of Human Services gave DEP a memo that all septic systems meet all their requirements. Same with turning advantage.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Can I follow up with another question?
Certainly.
Those areas outside the activities outside the standard building envelope shall be limited to activities required to maintain a safe, natural, properly drained buffer between lots and public ways and pedestrian easements or walkways as designated on the plan. That's note C on the applicant's plan. Again, I'll ask the question, in defining the building envelope, is one of the minimum setbacks from a property line either 10 or 15 feet in defining the building envelope?
The problem, Mr. Emery, is that the term building envelope is not a defined term in any of your ordinances. It is a term which is used internally by your staff and by you folks, but it's not a defined term. The ordinance regulates the placement of buildings with respect to their distance from lot lines, but does not limit the placement of septic systems. The only limitation of the placement of the septic system is the state plumbing code, which does regulate that in terms of 10-foot minimum.
Well, I understand that the
building envelope, as the note shows, and what the note refers to, is the building envelope that's placed on each lot.
That's correct. And I'm trying to determine what the minimum requirements are for establishing that building envelope. If there are none, then the thing ought to be on the property line, as far as I'm concerned. It would seem to me that either one minimum setback would be 10 feet for the placement of a septic system, or 15 feet, or whatever appropriate side, front, or rear yard setback for the building. And it seems to be consistently on the plan. It's either 30 feet along a property line, or in most cases, 15 feet along a side yard setback. The only point I'm trying to get to, is it the intent of defining that envelope to maintain a buffer strip between properties that as defined under note C, seems to me is that the purpose is to maintain a natural buffer strip that isn't to be cleared. And if that's the case, having seen septic systems constructed, it seems to me that the construction of a septic system would be an activity that is quite intensive. But if we can limit the, if those building envelopes can be as 10 feet, as close as 10 feet to the side yard of property line, then as far as I'm concerned, it's not an issue.
They can be. They were designed not to be in some areas.
I guess, again, it really gets to the issue of the layout of the plan and how difficult a development this is, and that property lines take very minor adjustments in order to fit to the very limited area of the septic system. And I just want to be very clear as to what the intent of get to what the chairman is pointing to and what the intent of these building envelopes are, because certainly clearing for a septic system that close to a property line is and closer in most cases than all other building envelopes line indicated on the plan is not consistent with the intent of providing a buffer between properties.
But it is clear that we can vegetate a septic system.
Only with grass and maybe low,
low
ground
shrubs.
Cover.
Mm-hmm. If If there are no further comments on D, then E, which was later modified slightly, let's see. Was that all necessary legal documentation relating to any activities permitted or prohibited inside and outside the building envelope shall also be prepared by the applicant, deemed acceptable by the town attorney and the town planner prior to submission of the final plan. Restrictions shall be placed in the final subdivision plan and within the deeds of each of the proposed lots. The language shall be reviewed and deemed acceptable by the town attorney and the planning board prior to the submission of the final plan. Frankly, I don't think that I've seen any of the proposed deeds. Has any other member of the planning board?
No, the notes are on the plan and the deeds reference the notes.
But the second sentence says that the restrictions shall be placed on the final plan and within the deeds, the language of
which
shall be...
Well, the deeds aren't drawn yet, Ms. Picard.
Excuse me?
The deeds are not drawn yet. We don't have any purchases yet.
Ah. Then that's the... I thought perhaps...
But they will be, of course. You cannot convey to someone without putting those conditions in the deed.
I thought perhaps you might be doing a proposed deed with some proposed language, but if it hasn't been done...
I think that was the intent at the time that this condition was made a part of the preliminary
Those
approval.
Deeds have been made up by our law firm and your town attorney on a hundredfold basis, and I'm sure Ms. McCaw's firm. They are a short-form warranty deed, which says lot so-and-so on a plan of so-and-so subject to the easements and conditions and restrictions shown thereon, period.
I guess what we haven't seen is the any of the deed restrictions.
Yes, you have. They are on the plan.
The plan.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, the notes on the plan would be sufficient to restrict any out-conveyances of any of the lots.
Put them in the deed or not?
Yeah, whether they're in the deed or not, frankly, any purchaser of a lot in the subdivision would be on notice of the notes and restrictions on the plan. So from the position of the town attorney, whether they're in the conveyance deed, and Judy knows this better than anyone, any purchaser would be subject to them.
Thank you, Michael. Condition F was that the building envelope on the southeastern portion of lot 6S be eliminated in order to ensure that no residential construction or septic system construction shall occur in close proximity to the existing wetland. Has that been accomplished, Maureen?
The building envelope is still in the plan. There is a note that's been added to the plan that says no septic system or building may be placed within this envelope.
I guess I would like to ask the town attorney, if I could, we get back to this building envelope issue, and it at least to me, is a fairly central and one of the issues before us. I'd make the argument just simply to remove the building envelope from Lot 6 in Phase 1. If the term building envelope, and I'm searching for the right term, not necessarily a legal term, but in the terms... that we've used with this application, as Mr. Emery has asked, the intent was to have a 15-foot buffer and other the wetlands buffers and so forth. All of those different criteria were included in drawing up the building envelope as we've envisioned this. But if there's no legal substance to the term building envelope, then the point is moot.
Well, it's not a defined term in our subdivision ordinances, but if it's shown on the plan where there's a building envelope, then any purchaser or builder would have to, could only construct within that envelope because according to the terms of the subdivision plan and approval, that's the only place that that construction is allowable. If we didn't have building envelopes, as long as a builder met the setback requirements, they could build anywhere on the lot. But over the years, in order to make more attractive subdivisions, the planning board has limited where on the lot itself this activity would take place. So while it's not a legally defined term in the ordinance, it would be, any purchaser would be bound by the plan, which shows where the building envelope is, and the note says you can't do X, Y, and Z outside the building envelope. If septic systems are included as those activities that can only be done in the building envelope, and the plan is approved that way, then they can't, a purchaser couldn't put a septic system outside that building envelope. So if your intent is to create that that buffer zone and require septic systems to be within the building envelope, then you've accomplished that. If you remove the building envelopes, then you don't have any restriction on where a building or septic system could be placed other than the setback requirements that are found in the ordinance.
Let's take an issue that's not a property boundary. Let's take wetlands, where the intent was to have a buffer around wetlands. Lot 10 in phase, I think it's 2, shows one of the septic system, the chamber system, in the wetland. Our intent was not to place septic systems in wetlands areas. Evidently the soils, and in my reading of the minimum state standards, doesn't even entail that. But our intent was not to have septic systems in the wetland.
Okay.
Yeah, that septic system is not in the wetland. It's adjacent to it, but it's not in the wetland. And again, that plan and that location has been reviewed by the DEP and approved by them.
I guess I just differ. You know, my eyes are different than yours. It shows that the lines go into the wetland. The wetland boundary that you have.
Scott, before you sit down, Mr. Chairman, might follow up on that issue. I think the thing that's confusing the issue is that the building envelope, if it were literally taken as that area within which a structure can be legally placed because of setbacks required from wetlands,